Thank you. Well, good morning, everybody. How is everybody doing today? It is so glad. I'm so glad to see you all. We're so grateful to have you here as we come together in worship. Here's Kathleen.
Sorry.
Last minute touch-ups.
Yes. Good morning, and you know, God forgives us even when we're late, which is me all the time, every day. So there we go. Aren't we blessed to live with such abundant grace? Okay, we have a few announcements today. Reminder that Angel Tree gifts are due to the Salvation Army locations on the ticket by Tuesday the 10th. Those are due by Tuesday, unwrapped gifts, okay? So do not worry about wrapping. You will drop them off with the ticket at those locations. The Handbell Choir is playing today in the 11 o'clock service, so be sure to stop in to that service. Come and worship with us as we enjoy the handbells. Next Sunday is the Children's Christmas Pageant. That will be happening at the 11 o'clock service. So again, we hope that you will come to both services next week. We will be having regular modern service, but the children's pageant will be presented at the 11, and that has been under the direction of Miss Erin Shellman and Miss Cindy Watson. So we are so blessed to have them as ministry partners for that endeavor, and the kids have worked so hard. On December 22nd is the cantata, and that will also be presented in full at the 11. We will have some selections from the cantata at this service as well at 9 o'clock on the 22nd. Again, just come on for double church in December. We hope that you'll be at all of those services. We also encourage you to invite a friend. So the postcards that you have seen laying around and that you got in the mail, we hope that you will use those to share with the friend, invite them to an Advent event, and just use that to start a conversation about how God works in your life. Yeah. And with that, we turn our hearts to worship.
Amen. So I invite everybody to stand up. We're going to go ahead and sing in praise this morning. We're getting close. We're still in Advent, but we're getting closer to Christmas. So we're going to go ahead and worship. We're going to sing some fun songs today as we give praise to God. Amen. The shepherds came to see the baby, stood by his mother's side. He laid the Savior inside a manger. Oh, what a glorious night. Oh, what a glorious night. Now I hear the angels singing, hallelujah. Shepherds wondered, they couldn't hide it, told everyone in sight. All were amazed when they heard how God came down on the glorious night. God came down on the glorious night. Now hear the angels singing, hallelujah, let the earth receive a king.
Jesus Christ is
stars shining in the sky. Below in Bethlehem, the King is sleeping. Oh, what a glorious night. Oh, what a glorious night. Amen and amen. We're going to go ahead and keep singing in praise. These are these fun big songs we get to do this time of year. So let's raise our voices as we sing together. Here comes heaven.
Amen. And now if you will say with me what we believe in our Advent affirmation of faith. You may be seated. We will invite Sandy and Rachel up to light our Advent wreath this morning. We welcome them.
In days when God's people longed for peace, Isaiah declared, "Comfort, O comfort, my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins."
We who gather today also seek comfort and peace. Yet we are unsatisfied with the ideas of peace that tells us to keep quiet and go with the flow. We long for real peace, true peace, just peace. We wait as people who yearn for peace that bears the fruit of community, equity, and flourishing for all.
We light this candle as a sign of God's peace. May they be beacons calling us to repent and to live the good news of Jesus Christ as we wait and watch and labor for the day when all people can gather together to worship and glorify God. Amen.
O come, Emmanuel.
Oh, come thou wisdom from on high, and order all things far and nigh. To us the path of knowledge show, and cause us in her ways to go.
Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God's with us, God covers us. Comes to you, O Israel, Israel, God's people. Let's do it again.
Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
Now turn to your neighbor and let's sing this morning to your neighbor, welcoming them into this season.
Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
And now it's going to require that you move just a minute. Go find someone that you haven't spoken to this morning yet and go welcome them as we sing to each other. Find somebody you haven't welcomed this morning. Love how we are just going around and greeting each other. So let's do it again. One more time. Find somebody else you haven't greeted this morning. It is so good to be in God's house this morning during this Advent season. As we wait during this season for the coming of the Christ child, we wait with expectation, knowing that God brings to us so many good gifts during this time. We are so grateful for God's commitment to us, that God gives us redemption in the Christ child. And we are so grateful for your commitment to Jesus Christ and to his church. At this time, I want to invite some people that are going to join the church today. I invite Rachel and Sandy to come forward. Y'all welcome them. Rachel and Sandy have been married for 8 years and have found their church home here. Praise be to God. Amen. And I also invite our newlyweds, Jenny and Nathan, who have been married for, what, a month? A month. A Monday is a month, along with Kate and Ross, to come and join the church this morning. They both come on knowing that this is where they want to live out their vows to Jesus Christ in the church, and we are so grateful for you all. I have two questions to ask. The first question is, as a member of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries, will you? Yes. And as a member of this congregation here, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness, will you?
Yes.
And now we welcome them and invite you to join with me on the screen. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we are so grateful for your presence this day. We ask for your blessing as we make these commitments. We ask, God, that you will continue to abound in your love and your grace, that you give us everything we need, and for this we are grateful. We ask that you bless these families and that you help them to continue to grow in your grace, that they will know your peace and your love each and every day, and so do we. Lord, we love you and praise you and give you great honor and all authority. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's welcome them again. And I just love how our lay people, lay leaders, know what to do. They just come up. Y'all give it up for Holly and for Albert as part of our lay leadership. Thank you. All right, after the service, somebody will get your picture. I don't know who, but somebody will. So don't run off, okay? And then you'll be able to greet them at the end of the service as well.
This time we'd like to invite our children to come forward for our children's message this morning.
Have a lovely group this morning. A nice big group of children. I'm so excited. Yes. All right. So good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning. So great to see y'all here this morning. So I need y'all to do me a favor. Can you put your listening ears on for me this morning? Okay. You ready?
put those big listening ears on for me. Did y'all hear that? Okay, so when you hear that, what do you think of? You hear a trumpet? Yes. What do you think?
A trumpet.
You hear a trumpet? So what? Okay. What else?
Whatever that is.
Whatever that is. I just love you, children.
I said I wasn't gonna call
you. I'm not going to tell you. I'm not going to tell you. Okay. So, anybody else? I'm not doing my children because we kind of know.
Noise.
You hear noise? Yes. Can I hear the sound one more time? Just, I'm so sorry. Hold on.
Opening the royal gates.
There we go. Yes, that's what Miss Shannon was kind of going for. Hold on. Yes.
War is starting.
Okay. I wasn't thinking about war.
I'm going to have to end this.
I think a song's going to start.
Okay. Yeah.
Red carpet.
Okay. One last one, and then Miss Shannon's going to move forward.
The trumpets that maybe that are welcoming Jesus into Bethlehem.
Okay. I was going with, when he said royal, Miss Shannon was kind of going for like an introduction. You hear that when you are introducing royalty, like kings and queens. It's called a fanfare. Have y'all heard of that word before? Say fanfare. Okay. So typically whenever people who are royal, like kings and queens, are getting introduced, there is a big fanfare. But there was one king of all kings who did not get a fanfare when this king was born into the world. Does anybody know who I'm thinking about?
Jesus.
Yes, Jesus. Jesus didn't get a fanfare. Jesus got a man named John, also referred to as John the Baptist, that was going around telling people to get their hearts and their lives together and in order because it was the coming of the Messiah. But Jesus didn't get a fanfare, but Jesus was, okay, Mr. Edward has something and I have something. Do you see what this is? It's a penny, right? It's a penny. But what is a penny worth? Yes, because Jesus was the 1 cent. You get it? Jesus was the 1 cent. Mr. Edward and Mr. Steve will bring you over after service. Thank you and have a blessed day.
I'm in kindergarten.
As our kids are moving toward the door, we want to give God great praise for our new members that just joined this morning. We also want to remember the family of Karen Houston. Her service was conducted here last Thursday. And we also want to remember Helen Shore, who will begin chemotherapy on December 23rd. So please keep Helen in your prayers as well. Let us turn our hearts to pray. God of grace, you blow the breath of life into our lungs. You have formed us in your image, and yet we acknowledge that sometimes we are not who you would have us to be. You challenge us to embrace the refining fire of your love, to meet you on the threshing floor of life, and to be washed as with fuller's soap. But in our heart of hearts, we would rather keep those things that would be removed in such an encounter. Compassionate God, greet us with your grace this day, for we need you. We cannot save ourselves, though we may be frantic with activity, our efforts do not yield peace, the peace that only you can give. Today, let us be quiet enough to hear your voice. Today, let us be still enough to feel your touch. Help us to find that place where we can receive as well as give, wait as well as act, and listen as well as speak. Our whole world needs your peace. God, this day we remember the family of Karen Houston, and we pray for our sister Helen Shore as she faces the battle of chemotherapy coming forward. Let us come before you and learn your ways, laying down our weapons, feeding the hungry. Through your grace, life-giving God, accept us as we are, unrefined, unwashed. Help us to move into a new way of being. God, your grace is wider than our wildest imaginations. Your grace embraces us as we are and where we are, and draws us out to be the people we were created to be. God, we pray all of this, and we offer as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Right, as we wait for the coming of Christ in a manger, may we all not wait in silence, but being active in the word, bring the goodness of God to all. So now let us all together, from our free will and from our joy, bring God's tithes and our offerings.
Light of the world, treasure of heaven, brilliant like the stars in the wintry sky. Joy of the Father, reach through the darkness
God, we thank you for all your many blessings, and so we give back to you in this season of Advent as we prepare a place for all your people to come and to find you and to know your love, your grace, and your mercy. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
First test today is from Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. Let us now hear this text from Malachi. See, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, indeed he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand where he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord as in the days of old and in former years. Now, our gospel lesson for today is from Luke chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea, and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. There were three persons who arrived at the pearly gates at the same time, and St. Peter said he had to go to take care of something and he'd be right back, but could they just please wait there in line? He was gone for a long time, and finally he came back and he called one of the new arrivals and he asked him if she had minded waiting. And she says, oh no, I've looked forward to this for so long. I love God and I can't wait to meet Jesus. I don't mind at all. So St. Peter says, well, I have one more question. How do you spell God? And she said, capital G-O-D. And St. Peter says, okay, come on, come right in. So he went outside and he got another arrival, one of the new ones. And he said, come on in, but, you know, did you mind waiting? And he said, oh, no, I've been a Christian all my life. I don't mind waiting one bit. I'm just looking forward to expending eternity here. So St. Peter says, well, just one more thing. How do you spell God? He said, G-O-D, capital G-O-D. And St. Peter said, well, that's good, and sent him on into heaven. So St. Peter went out and invited the third person in and asked him if he had minded waiting. And he said, well, a matter of fact, I did. I had to stand in line all my life. Everywhere I went, I had to stand in line. I stood in line. I waited patiently at the store, at work, other places. I've waited and waited, and I resent having to wait in line for heaven now, St. Peter says. Well, that's all right for you to feel that way, and it won't be held against you. But there's just one more question. How do you spell Czechoslovakia? That's an old joke. It's now, of course, a two-state republic, right? Czech Republic and Slovakia. I sure hope my preaching professor's not watching today. But we don't particularly like to wait, do we? We don't like to wait. We're impatient, and we want to just go ahead and get what we think that we want, and we want to go ahead and not wait in line. We don't particularly like to wait, but during this time of Advent, here we are waiting. Here we are waiting again for Christmas Day, waiting for the Christ child. Advent means that we wait and we prepare for our hearts, and it is a time of stillness, a time of prayer, a time of reflection. And often waiting comes quiet, right? We wait in the silence of this season, and some of you are like, you hadn't been to my house. It's not silent at our house. The kids are so excited. And it won't be silent next week when our children present their play at the 11 o'clock service, the not-so-silent night. And as Kathleen says, you can come to two services for the next 2 weeks. This time of Advent, though, is a time of waiting, of being patient. In our scripture today, John the Baptizer burst in on the scene and is anything but quiet. He comes on the scene dressed a little oddly. He's got this wild tale about being out in the wilderness. And he doesn't seem to fit so much in with all the Christmas pleasantries that we're experiencing now. We are feeling good this time. How many of you are feeling pretty good, enjoying the Christmas season and Advent? But every year on the second Sunday of Advent, John the Baptizer comes in and disrupts our niceness. John's father, Zechariah, was a priest from the order of Abijah. He was chosen to offer incense in the temple, a holy duty only to be performed by the priest. And while he was doing his duty, the angel Gabriel appeared and told him that his wife would conceive and bear a son, and he was to name him John. An odd request, because most children were named after their parents. And John did not believe that this would happen because they were both old in age, and Elizabeth had not had any children, could not have children, and because Zechariah did not believe, he was then struck mute until the day that these things came to pass. The angel told Zechariah that the child John would be different than other children, that he would be filled with the Holy Spirit even before his birth. And the angel said that John would turn the hearts of many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. He would turn the hearts of parents to their children, the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteousness, to be made ready, a people prepared for the Lord. And at John's presentation in the temple on the eighth day, Zechariah's speech was restored, and he spoke a great word, telling the people that his son John was given by God to prepare the way for the Lord, to give knowledge of salvation to his people for the forgiveness of sin. So John comes out of the wilderness today as we've been patiently waiting. John comes on the scene interrupting our Christmas cheer. He comes on the scene interrupting the world stage in this text of seven historical political figures that are listed here in this text. He comes on the scene of world rulers inaugurating a new era, announcing the word of the Lord, and doing so with a message of repentance. Repentance, turning the hearts of people towards God, getting ready for the coming of the Messiah into the world. And it's a powerful message, a message that will turn the events of the world, that will turn the events of the world at that time and today. It's powerful, but really? Can't we just continue wearing our ugly Christmas sweaters and enjoying chestnuts roasting by an open fire? Can't we just do that and just ignore all this call to repentance? Repent is such a heavy word. We don't want to talk about it. We don't want to hear it. It's such a harsh thing to ask of the people in this season of good cheer as we wait with patience. We're asked to repent of the things that hold us back from God. We are asked to repent of the things that taint our world and our beautiful lives and causes brokenness and disruption in the world. Really? On the second Sunday of Advent, John the Baptist? Really? I had a friend that sent me a picture of a necklace that he's buying for his partner this Christmas and said, "Don't you think this is just perfect? The most perfect gift?" And I said, "Yes." I texted him back and said, "Oh, it's really, really nice. It's and knowing them, he will really love it." And some of you have been looking for the perfect gift, right, for your loved one. Someone here bought someone else a big new pink puffy jacket and keeps them warm. It's a wonderful gift. But many of us are looking for that perfect gift for someone that we care about. Well, here's the perfect gift from John the Baptist today. Repent. That's the perfect gift. Giving over to God the things that hold us back, the things that keep us from being who God wants us to be. Repent. Because repentance brings freedom. Repentance brings peace to ourselves and to others. Repentance removes the ugly of life. When we repent, we give a gift to ourselves so we can become who God has called us to be. Repentance is a gift that we give to ourselves because we can then become whole and be who God wants us to be. Repentance is a gift that we give to ourselves. It's a gift that we give to others so that everyone can live in peace. Repentance is a gift that we give to our families and to our friends because they see the change in us. And we put away the things that cause disruption and brokenness in our relationships. Repentance is a gift that we give to God. We give a gift to God out of response to God's goodness. So what is it that we need to repent of? Maybe it's the repentance of being judgmental. I admit that sometimes I judge people. I try not to, but, you know, it's just part of our human nature. Do you know that there are some people that don't recycle? Yeah, good. Y'all are laughing. But sometimes I have just a little bit of judgment about that. Because recycling for me is just one very small thing that we can do to help the environment and to take care of God's creation. What do we need to repent of? Maybe it's some other kind of judgment. Maybe it's a judgment of someone because of maybe how they look or where they've been or what they've done. What is it that we need to repent of? The prejudices that we have within us? Because all of us have something that we are tainted by the ways of the culture and the ways that we've been brought up in different ways. I think younger generations are a little less susceptible to this than than adults are, that children do not notice that they may be different from one another. Instead, they are taught that by society. They're taught that by the culture. What is it that we need to repent of? Maybe it's, for some of us, it's our anger. Or maybe it's talking about someone behind their back. Well, maybe it's something that we need to repent of that keeps us from enjoying the goodness of God and understanding God's peace for the gift that God wants to give to us every day. Maybe it's despair, worry and fear and anger and anxiety and stress. Anybody? All right, let me go through that list again. Worry, fear, anger, anxiety, stress. Everybody on that last one, raise your hand. Maybe it's the feeling of being overwhelmed. And all these things try to take up residence in our life. They try to take up residence in our life and enter into our lives. Maybe it's the desire that we have. And whether we want to admit it or not, maybe there's something in our human nature that we desire for violence within us and among us. I don't think we want to admit it, but sometimes we like to watch those videos of road rage, right? We enjoy those, or the fight that breaks out at the store over some Christmas shopping. You know, it's kind of entertaining. Maybe there's something in us that kind of likes that kind of violence. Maybe it's the lack of concern for our neighbor that we need to repent to. And maybe it's the seclusion we tend to migrate. Oh, I really didn't see that. I don't know their need. And we just look straight ahead instead of looking around. Maybe the things that we need to repent of is that we pretend that our world is the only world that matters. Maybe what we need to repent of is our lack of commitment to the ways of God. I don't know. I just know that John the Baptist comes today to tell us to repent, because this repentance brings peace. With repentance comes forgiveness. With repentance comes forgiveness and freedom to live in a life, to live our lives for God in a way that God is pleased with, so that we can experience the peace of Christ this Christmas. Forgiveness without repentance is called, we call, cheap forgiveness. We are forgiven by God for all these things and more, and when we turn from them and we repent, meaning that we turn and we do something different, and we turn them over to God, the things that keep us from being who God wants us to be, the things that break the world apart, and we live as a changed person. We are forgiven and set free. What a gift this is. What a gift. For when we repent, the world is a little closer than what for what God wants it to be. When we repent, when we turn from the things of the world to the things of God, our lives are a lot closer to what God wants us to be. So John the Baptist calls from the wilderness today, calling us to repent. John the Baptist reminds us through Malachi today that the paths will be made straight, the valleys will be filled, the hills will be made low, and everything will change. Everything will be made right. Like the refiner's fire, says Malachi. When we repent, we are made righteous, and God purifies us and makes us into something new. If only we will receive the gift of repentance and use it to make our roads straight. If only we will give our hearts over to God this year, this Advent, as we patiently wait, whether we can spell or not, as we wait, patiently wait for the coming of the Lord, the coming of the Christ child in a manger, and we offer the gift. What gift can we give him? We can only give him the gift of our hearts and ourselves, given the gift of turning our hearts over to God so that God can work in us and through us, refine us and make us more into who God wants us to be, to bring about peace to our families, to bring about love to the world, to give this great gift, the gift that we've been given, to give this great gift in response to God's goodness given to us in a manger. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
All right. Well, I invite you all, we're going to sing one last song together. I need everyone to sing this really loud, so I invite everybody to stand up as we accept this beautiful gift of repentance from God and we sing in response to God.
Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing.
glory to God in the highest. May you go out into this world and share this great love with everyone you meet. May they know the gift that we are to receive in the Christ child. May you be a witness to this great love. And may you go in the love of God, the peace of Christ, the communion of the Holy Spirit, this day forevermore. Amen. Go in peace, my friends. Go in peace.